C'est bon, c'est parti.
All right, so I will start. So it's my great, great pleasure to introduce Sébastien Carnicella. Sébastien was supposed to come to Bordeaux for Anaïs' defense, but this will be for the next time. So Sébastien is team leader at INSERM in the Neuroscience Institute of Grenoble, so the GIN, and his team is entitled Pathophysiology of Motivation. So research work of Sébastien is mainly focused on motivational aspects of different disorders with multidisciplinary approaches from sophisticated behavior to also functional neuroanatomy, but also neuropharmacology and cell signaling. So at the beginning of his career, Sébastien did his PhD in Strasbourg. In the team of Jean-Marie Dagnon, working on the role of the cholinergic system in contingency, with the aim to explore the neurobiological basis of delirium. Then Sébastien moved to San Francisco in the lab of Dorit Rohn to work on alcohol-related alteration of motivational processes. So to do so, he focused his attention in the dorsal and ventral striatum, on molecules such as GDNF, BDNF, but also AMPA and NMDA receptors, and the rapamycin pathway. Back to France, then he joined the team of the Marc Zavasta in Grenoble to work on motivational disorders in Parkinson's disease. There, he produced a very dense literature about the neurobiological mechanisms of apathy and alteration of motivational processes in Parkinson's disease, and notably by highlighting the role of dopamine D3 receptors, dopamine receptors. With his work, so Sébastien explored several new pharmacological treatments to ameliorate motivational processes in the different diseases he worked on. And Sébastien published in renowned journals such as Journal of Neuroscience, PNAS, Biology, Psychiatry, Movement Disorders, or Brain. He also obtained several fundings, in particular ANR, Fondation de France, or France Parkinson. Sébastien's current research is about the characterization of the dopaminergic system in compulsive behaviors related to alcohol addiction, and this is what he will talk to us today. So, Sébastien, welcome.
Thanks, Clémentine, for this very nice introduction and for inviting me today to give this this presentation. I'm very happy and impressed at the same time because Bordeaux is one of the best universities to talk about motivation and addiction. So I will try my best. I also apologize for being unable to come physically. And it will be also a pain for me because with my Italian name, I like to move everywhere when I'm talking. So I'm a little bit frustrating to be forced to be on my chair, but I will try to do my best to be dynamic and clear. So as Clémentine told you, yes, I will talk today about compulsive behavior in alcohol addiction and the potential implication of dopamine in the nigrostriatal pathway is clearly actually the main pathway we are working on in the lab, trying to understand how it can be implicated in motivated behavior and in pathological motivated behavior. So addiction, most of you know exactly what it is, but it's still something that it's controversial to what kind of pathology it is, if it's a pathology of motivation, of decision, of choice. But if you do a brief summary, we can say that drug addiction, it's a chronic disorder that can be characterized by four main features. If we group the different criteria of diagnostic of the DSM-5, for instance, it will be the same thing with the ICD-10 or 11. The first main feature will be an excessive and uncontrolled consumption. The second one will be a negative emotional and motivational state during abstinence, which can be called that psychological withdrawal. It can be also physical withdrawal, but it's something that will not occur with all drug abuse, and it's not a really important feature of addiction for me. The third features will be the loss of interest in social and occupational activities. Your interest for the drug increase abnormally in expense of other activities. It's really something that will impair daily activity and your social and professional life. And also one of the main criteria for addiction, it's compulsive drug seeking and taking with craving, which is a strong desire to seek and take the drug that will usually lead to relapse, and that's the critical factor that we need to control to avoid the relapse, which is the main issue in addict people. So below, you have a kind of scheme of different kind of drug use, because no drug addiction is defined as a substance use disorders. You have, of course, the occasional recreative use, which is a normal control use of the drug. That can be later can lead to drug abuse, which is still a controlled consumption, but the consumption starts to be excessive and harmful. And then the last step, the more severe one, that we can really define as addiction, as a compulsive state, is clearly an incapacity to control the consumption and the seeking to take to use the drug, with this negative cycle, with binge intoxication of a large amount of the drug, abstinence that was forced or voluntary, but that will lead to the development of a strong negative affect with loss of motivation, depression, anxiety, very bad feelings, the craving with this compulsive desire to take the drug, that will finally, in most of people, lead to relapse with, again, a huge amount of the drug that will be taken. And at this moment, we are still almost unable to stop this negative spiral, and we are lacking of effective treatments for most of the people at this stage. And especially because we still don't know exactly what kind of mechanism are underlying this this specific aspect of addiction, the most severe one. I told you that I present you that as a kind of transition from... Oui, there is a... That a kind of transition for a control use to a non-control use, but it's good to keep in mind that for some individuals, you can have probably a direct entry directly to the addiction state without a repeated and chronic exposure to the drug that will lead to the development of addiction in specific individuals that have already a compulsive nature, already a failure in their psychobiological mechanism to inhibit unadaptive behavior. And the drug will be just the expression of this already present pathological state. Okay. So I present you that as a kind of transition, but keep in mind that you can have a direct entry to addiction. And some people, of course, unfortunately, most of the people, we keep their use as occasional, and even will never be further a drug abuse state. If we look at alcohol use disorder, because it's the topic of the talk today, most of people, say more than 70%, will keep the consumption as occasional or recreative. 20% of the user will become alcohol abuser, and less than 10% will be really defined as addict to alcohol. So it means that most of the people are protected against addiction, But some people are vulnerable to that, and we still need to understand what will cause this development of addiction. What is the basis of this vulnerability? So to understand that, we are focusing on dopamine. I think that most of you will say, okay, dopamine again, it's a long story. Probably we know everything about dopamine, but still surprisingly, even if it was the first neurotransmitter thought to be involved in addiction, there is still a lot of question and debate about when dopamine is involved in addiction, in which stage, in the initiation, or clearly it's still involved in the compulsive nature of addiction. How is it involved? What kind of mechanism of alteration in the dopaminergic system can be involved in addiction, and where in the brain also? So there is still all these questions, and I think that's why there is still no efficient dopamine-based therapy for addiction. So it's still a main question in the field. Just as a reminder, I represent you briefly the two main dopaminergic system in the forebrain, the mesocorticolimbic one with the dopaminergic neurons from the VTA, the ventral tegmental area, that will project mainly to the nucleus accumbens and the prefrontal cortex, putatively involved in motivation and limbic functions, and the dopaminergic neurons from the substantia nigra, projecting to the dorsal striatum, know for their implication in the motor function and dysfunction as in Parkinson's disease, but we will see that it's also a crucial system for the control of motivated behavior. What we know from the mesolimbic system, because it was the first system investigating in drug addiction due to their role in motivation, it makes sense. Is that when you are exposing rodents or humans to alcohol, there is a large increase in dopamine release in the nucleus accumbens. Interestingly, during abstinence, after withdrawal, when the drug is not on board anymore, you can see that the level of dopamine, they are not going back to the basal level that you can see in controls animals or in healthy humans, but you will have a decrease in dopaminergic function with a decrease in DHEA levels in the nucleus accumbens. So we have this fluctuation between hyper and hypodopaminergic. What we know about hyperdopaminergic state, this supranormal or permanent release of dopamine under the drug, is that it will lead to abnormal behavior, abnormal motivation to take the drug. Here, it's a normal individual that will have several interests and activities in his life between professional and personal activities. The alcohol can be one of them, but it's only a small part of his activities. After repeated exposure to the drug and excessive exposure to the drug, some theories of such incentive theory of dopamine believe that the drug will lead to an abnormal dopaminergic signaling that will increase abnormally the interest for the drug at the expense of the other activity. So if you have choice for the drug or for other activity, compared to a normal individual, you will prefer to take the drug, even if it's at the expense of the other activity. About the hypodopaminergic state, there was the theory of allostasis that was first developed by Koub and Lemoyle, so in Bordeaux. That is interesting to try to explain why abstinence can lead to relapse. So you are taking the drug, you have an increase of dopamine in the nucleus accumbens. You have compensatory mechanisms that will be developed by the brain to try to counteract this increase that are called opponent processes. And so with time and the repetition of the drug, this opponent processes that lead to a decrease of dopamine will be larger and permanent, far beyond the effect of the drug on dopamine release. And so you will see that with time and chronicity, you will have a new basal level of dopamine that is lower to the normal level of dopamine called an allostatic state. And it is supposed that this state will lead to excessive alcohol intake, relapse, and it can also account for the motivational deficit, the depression and anxiety symptoms that are observed during withdrawal. And there was a lot of study about the implication of the mesolimbic system also in the potential implication of hypodopaminergia in alcohol use disorder. And I will just talk about a part of my work we did during my postdoc in San Francisco, because it's the basis of the talk today. And what I will show you after, it's really a follow-up of this story more than 10 years after. I learned that in science, you need to be patient. So what we did is that we use as a model of induction of excessive alcohol intake an intermittent access to alcohol when the animals, during 24 hours, they have access to a bottle of water and a bottle of ethanol. 24 hours later, we are removing the ethanol bottle for 24 hours and they only have access to water. And we will repeat this cycle during around 7 weeks. So it mimics a little bit the cycle that you have between a day when you will be able to consume a lot amount of alcohol and a day when you are forced to be abstinent and so on. To repeat this kind of a negative spiral between drinking a lot, being abstinent, drinking a lot, being abstinent, so on. And you can see that with this, this model, you can have a nice escalation of ethanol intake. At the beginning, the animal, they really drink a moderate amount of alcohol during 24 hours. And with time, this intake will increase to a high level of ethanol intake. And also when they have access to the ethanol bottle again, they will drink really a large amount of alcohol in a short period of time. So we really have animals that are binging with a high level of intoxication. It was interesting because this kind of escalation, it was something that was first evidenced and studied by Serge Ahmed in Bordeaux when he was a postdoc in the lab of George Koub with cocaine, with a model of long access. And it is an interesting feature of alcohol dependence. Which was interesting is that when we look at dopaminergic level with this model in the nucleus accumbens, we were able to see that after 24 hours of withdrawal, compared to animals that have still alcohol on board or water control, there is a decrease of dopamine in the nucleus accumbens. So they are voluntary drinking alcohol, and the correlate of that is this hypodopaminergic state in the mesolimbic system. What we did on this animal is that we infused directly GDNF, the glial-derived neurotrophic factor, into the ventral tegmental area. Why? It's because we know that GDNF is able to reverse this hypodopaminergic state by stimulating moderately dopaminergic neurons. So as you can see, in animals that are in withdrawal for alcohol, by giving GDNF directly into the VTA, you are able to correct this hypodopaminergic state. And this was associated with a decrease in ethanol consumption. There is no more in this animal excessive alcohol consumption. They are still consuming alcohol, but in a normal and moderate level. So it's one example. There is a lot of other studies from the lab of Doritron or other lab showing that there is clearly a link between excessive consumption, the negative effect, and dopamine deficiency in the mesolimbic system. But what remains unclear is is hypodopaminergic state participate to compulsive drug use? Excessive consumption is one of the features of addiction, but what is critical in the severe state of addiction is the compulsivity. And for that, the implication of hypodopaminergic state are still under investigate or controversial, and especially nobody was able to find a link between hypodopaminergic state of the mesolimbic pathway and compulsivity. So compulsive drug use, just as a reminder, the definition is clearly the continuation of the use of the substance despite the knowledge of having negative consequences. We know that it's bad, that it's harmful for you, for your environment, for everyone around you, but still you are unable to stop. That's the critical issue in addiction. And so what we think about, it was about the neighboring system, the nigrostriatal one, in compulsivity. Because if we do a very short summary of the literature, we know that the nucleus accumbens is important for excessive motivation, excessive intake, but another part of the literature of studies show that probably the dorsal part of the striatum, and more specifically the dorsolateral part of the striatum, the one that is should be involved only in the motor function, is important for the loss of control and the development of compulsive drug use. So it means that if we have to look to hypodopaminergia and its possible implication in compulsivity, we should look at hypodopaminergia in the nigrostriatal system. We have other evidence that drive us to go in this direction. In the lab, we are also working on Parkinson's disease and on the non-motor aspect of Parkinson's disease. And part of the work that was described by Clementine during the introduction is that we develop a model of partial nigrostriatal dopaminergic lesion to avoid the motor deficit that are induced when you have a severe lesion of the system, to be able to evaluate other aspects of the behavior. And with this approach, we were able to find that these animals with a decrease of dopamine in the nigrostriatal system only, they have strong motivational deficits, and they also develop anxiety and depression related behavior. So this was really reminiscent of the negative state that occur during abstinence and withdrawal. So it was really striking to me that these animals, they have a kind of phenotype that occur during abstinence, even if they were never exposed to the drug. We also know that in abstinent patients, there is also a reduction of dopamine in the dorsal striatum. It occurs in the mesolimbic system, but also in the dorsal striatum, and it's associated with craving. And also, there is the work of the School of Cambridge, mainly by Barry Everitt and David Belin, showing that if you are blocking the dopaminergic system in the dorsolateral part of the striatum, you are able to reduce compulsive seeking in rats. But nobody, as far as we know, has looked at a potential hypodopaminergic state in the nigrostriatal pathway and its implication in compulsivity. So it was the question that Raphael has to answer during his PhD. He's a really brilliant student that just defended his thesis last week, and I will present all his work. So we reason this way. We say, okay, if there is an hypodopaminergic state in the nigrostriatal pathway that participates to the development of compulsivity, we can make several predictions. The first is that the dopaminergic function in the dorsal striatum should be decreased in animals with a compulsive drug use versus normal and controlled use of alcohol. Also, if we are decreasing the dopaminergic function in the dorsal striatum, we should be able to induce compulsive drug use in animals that are non-compulsive. And also we made a third prediction is that probably by decreasing the dopaminergic function, compulsivity should also be associated with the development of a negative withdrawal-like phenotype with motivational deficit and anxiety and depression-like behavior, like we observed before with depression. So to answer the first, to test the first prediction, we had to find an approach that will be able to distinguish between animals that will keep the control over their consumption and the animal that will lose the control and that will persevere to take the drug and to seek the drug, even in the front of a negative consequences. So this is the design we used. We used the intermittent access protocol to induce excessive alcohol intake, as before. Then the animals, they were trained to take alcohol in operant self-administration chambers to press on the lever to obtain alcohol during a 30-minute session. And when this operant behavior is fully acquired, they will be exposed to mild food shocks. So every time they will try to press on the lever, not every time, but every 8 presses, when they will respond to obtain alcohol, they will have a mild food shock. That will be able us to discriminate between the animal that will stop virtually their operant behavior and the one that will continue. And then at the end, we'll took the nucleus accumbens, dorsomedial and dorsolateral striatum to do some ELISA to evaluate the level of dopamine in these different tissues. So below are the results. You have the acquisition of the excessive alcohol consumption between the animal that will be, at the end of the experiment, defined as compulsive and non-compulsive. And you can see that the escalation is pretty similar between both groups. So it was really interesting because it means that you have animals that will lose control over their consumption, others not, but they are consuming the same amount of alcohol. It was something that was already demonstrated for cocaine by Valérie Desroches-Gamonnet, David Belin and Pierre V. Piazza in Bordeaux. So it's interesting. It's not only about consumption. It's really about the control you have on that. So it was also interesting because the amount of alcohol consumed, the history of alcohol, is not a bias. It's not something that was able to bias your evaluation of dopamine levels. Then during the operant self-administration, we obtain also the same basal level of self-administration between the resistant and sensitive food shock rat. And you can see that when they were exposed to the food shock, the animal in yellow, the sensitive one, progressively decrease their operant behavior to avoid to take the shock. So they are able to stop to seek and consume the drug to avoid the negative consequences. But the other animals, the compulsive one, the one we have defined as compulsive, they persist to take the drug. And even during the first day of exposure, they have this huge increase that I will be interested to discuss later, if you have some idea about why they did this behavior. But clearly, you have this nice persistence in seeking and taking the drug despite the negative consequences. And what was really exciting for me is to see that if you look at the distribution of the animals, we don't have a Gaussian distribution, we really have a bimodal distribution. So it clearly means for me that, okay, it's artificial because the proportion of animals that will be resistant or sensitive will probably change with the intensity of the shock, but clearly we have two different populations. Is that clear? And this is the result for dopamine. We can see that at the level of the nucleus accumbens and of the dorsomedial striatum, there is no change of dopamine between the sensitive and the resistant rat. We also include a water control that have the intermittent access protocol, but only with water, just to control for potential stress parameters. And this, the levels are the same, and there is absolutely no correlation between air levels in these structures and the level of resistance to the shock. But interestingly, in the dorsolateral part of the striatum, you can see this reduction of dopaminergic contents in the resistant group compared to the sensitive and the control, the water control group. And also, there is this correlation between the level of dopamine and the resistance to shock. It means that the more the animal was resistant to the shock, the more the dopamine levels in the dorsolateral striatum were low. So, okay, we have a correlation between, so first, we were able to observe hypodopaminergic state in this pathway. We were able to associate this hypodopaminergic state to compulsive alcohol use, but it's not a causal demonstration. We still don't know if this hypodopaminergic state participates to the development of this compulsive behavior. So for that, we decide to use chemogenetics in order to induce this hypodopaminergic state experimentally, specifically in the nigrostriatal system. And for that, we use Th-Cray rats that express the recombinase cray under the Th promoter to have the recombinase in the substantia nigra only in dopaminergic neurons. And we infused in the SNC a flux virus to express the HM4DI thread, which is a mutated muscarinic receptor coupled to a GI protein to specifically inhibit the neurons of interest. So when we will apply a specific dread ligand, we will activate this receptor and inhibit specifically dopaminergic neurons. So this is the theory. So we decide first to be sure that with this approach, we will be able to efficiently and specifically inhibit dopaminergic neurons. So here it's just a picture of the infection we have in the substantia nigra. So we were able to infect around 60% of the dopaminergic neurons in the distal part of the SNC, a little bit less in the medial part, and very few neurons in the ventral tegmental area. We know that sometimes, so we only also see the expression, the M-Sherry staining in neurons that were Th positive. But we know that it's possible that sometime with flux virus, there is expression of the transgene in neurons that don't have the expression of the cray. It's something that was recently showed by Shona Parks, for instance. So what we did first is that in some animals, destroy the nigrostriatal dopaminergic pathway with a neurotoxin that we use for your Parkinsonal model with a full lesion. And we infuse the virus in the intact and lesioned side. And you can see that there is absolutely no staining in the side with no dopaminergic neurons. So clearly indicating that in our end, with the parameters we have, we are specific to dopaminergic neurons in this brain region. Next, what we did is that we use as a dread ligand C21, a synthetic ligand that was recently developed for dread. And we wanted to be sure that the effect of the ligand will be selective to the dread and with a dose that will be efficient and selective to specifically inhibit dopaminergic neurons with the H M4DI receptor. So with electrophysiology, we record the activity of neurons in the SNC. And then with microdialysis, we evaluate the impact on dopaminergic levels in the dorsal striatum. So with this dose of C21, you can see that 90 minutes after the ligand injection, we were able to see a significant decrease in the activity of neurons in the SNC with multi-recording. And concomitantly, 19 minutes after the injection of the ligand, we were also able to see a decrease in dopaminergic levels in the dorsal striatum. It was more transient than what we observe at the level of the activity of the neurons, but during at least 45 minutes, we were able to see this hypodopaminergic state. We also look at dopaminergic levels in the nucleus accumbens, just to be sure that neuroanatomically we were selective. And as you can see here, there was no effect on dopaminergic levels. So we were really specific to the nigrostriatal system. So what are the consequences of this manipulation on the behavior? We use exactly the same procedures. After acquisition of operant self-administration, we infused the flox virus with the DREAD or just with MSHERI as a control. And then we select the animals that are sensitive to the shock, to the food shock. So we did exactly the same experiment as before, but we only keep the animals that were sensitive to the food shock. It was when we infused the saline, the pharmacological control. And then the sensitive food shock animal were infused with C21 to see what will be the effect of the induced hypodopaminergic state on their reaction to food shock. And here are the results. So under NACL, under saline, you can see that all the animals decrease their operant behavior when they receive food shock. They are able to recover after this period. And then when we apply the food shock again, but this time with C21, you can see that the controls animal with just the MSHERI flox virus, they are still decreasing their operant behavior, but progressively in the animals that receive C21 chronically, you can see this increase in operant behavior, meaning that they start to be resistant to the food shock and continue to seek and take the drug. So we were really happy to see that this experimental induction of hypodopaminergic state can causally induce an increase in compulsive-like behavior, which was also nice if you look at the individual, is that each animal increased their resistance under C21 in the HM4DI group. And also, there was this correlation between the level of expression of the transgene, at least of the MSHERI level we obtain, and the increase in resistance, the level of increase in resistance they have. So the more the infection was efficient, the more the resistance of the animal increased. We also test the effect of C21 without food shock to be sure that the effect we have was really linked to a resistance to the food shock and not just to a change in motivation for the drug under C21. And there was no effect without food shock. We also wanted to be sure that this hypodopaminergic state will not change the sensitivity to the food shock. And so when we look at the behavioral reactivity to food shock, it's the same between all the groups. So it's the animals they are not pressing on the behavior on the lever because they are not sensitive to the food shock. They are still feeling the aversive effect of the food shock, but still they persist to press. So it was a really important control. I will go very fast because I just realized that I already talked too much. It's just for the last part about the motivational and affective related dimensions. So we look at motivation using an operant sucrose self-administration procedure that we used before with the nigrostriatal dopaminergic lesion we investigate in the lab. And you can see that when you are inducing the hypodopaminergic state with C21, we are indeed able to decrease the operant behavior of the animals. It was also interesting that after 3 injections, when we are stopping the treatment, there is still a period without C21, several days after, when the animals still have a decrease in their operant behavior, even during the wash. So it means that there is a kind of persistent effect on behavior of this manipulation. We look at the motor function and also at the sensitivity of the reward of these animals because we wanted to be sure that this decrease was really linked to motivation and not an issue of the animals to press on the lever as we are impacting the nigrostriatal system or just a lack of sensitivity to sucrose, that it was really linked to the fact that they don't want to work anymore to take sucrose. And as you can see rapidly, there was no effect of the dread manipulation on adjustments of the forepaws, on spontaneous locomotor activity, and neither on preference for the sucrose solution that was used in the self-administration or sucrose intake. So it means that they're still liking sucrose. They can press as the control animals, but still, they are pressing less, so we are really interpreting that as a deficit in motivation to seek and take sucrose. We also look at some anxiety-related and depression-related behavior, and surprisingly, we find absolutely no effect in the lag-dark avoidance test, so it means that the animals, they were not more anxious than the control, and no depression-like behavior in the four-swim test too. We also use other tests like the elevated plus maze, and it was the same thing. Whatever the test, we never find any deficit linked to affective-related behavior. The only deficit we obtained was on motivation. So now I'm done. I just have a short conclusion. So just to summary, We knew that hypodopaminergic state in the mesolimbic pathway was involved in excessive intake and also on the negative motivational and affective state during withdrawal. But what was really unclear was the participation of hypodopaminergic state in compulsivity. So what we found with this study is for us, an important piece of this puzzle, which is a complex puzzle with addiction, is that if you want to look at an implication of hypodopaminergic state in compulsivity, you should look at what's going on in the neighboring nigrostriatal pathway. And it might also be involved in negative emotional state during withdrawal, but its implication is in more emotional state. Need really to be investigated, and it's not sure that it will be it will participate to that. But for the main question about compulsivity, it's a first step to indicate the participation of such dopaminergic deficiency in compulsive alcohol use. Something was really intriguing to us. It's the fact that finally, the induction of hypodopaminergy with the chemogenetic manipulation we did not change motivation for alcohol, but decrease motivation for sucrose. It really reminds us what's going on when with drug of abuse, with the problem of choice, when you have an interest that will increase for the drug at the expense of the other, and the motivation for the other activity will be reduced. And there is this nice model that was developed and characterized by Serge Amen in Bordeaux, showing that in animals that should be addict, if they have the choice between the drug and natural reward like sucrose, they will prefer the drug in comparison to sucrose, in comparison to normal animals that will prefer sucrose. But it's fairly something that we should try in this kind of models to see if we will be able in these animals to increase the choice toward alcohol compared to sucrose. And there is still this important question, is the fact that the role of dopamine in addiction seems highly paradoxical, because sometimes it seems to be linked to an increased activity of the system, and sometimes it seems to be linked to an hypoactivity of the system. And it seems that both are true, because empirically, you have very nice and rigorous studies showing that when you are increasing the dopaminergic function, you are able to increase addiction-related behavior. And other studies showing that where you are reducing the dopaminergic function, you are also able to increase addiction-related behavior. And I think that there is a possibility to reconcile this. Is just saying that you have at the same times hypo and hyperdopaminergy in addiction. And to think about that, you have just to keep in mind that there is two complementary modes of action of dopamine in the brain. And we are not discussing enough about that. Is the fact, I mean, for people that are doing electrophysiology is obvious, but for people that are doing mainly behavior, we are not thinking enough about this aspect. Is the fact that there is two modes of action, that you have a tonic dopaminergic activity that will define the basal level of dopamine in the brain, in the nucleus accumbens, in the dorsal striatum, and in other targeted structures. And there is a phasic activity, very short in time, that can be detected by fast cyclic voltammetry, that will lead to fast signaling signal that will be related to the detection of novelty, of relevant stimuli for the animals, etc. And what is important is the ratio between this phasic and tonic signal, that it will be important to be detected and to be detected to a normal signal. And what's going on in an addiction state is that probably you have a low tonic dopaminergic levels. It's the hypodopaminergic state of addiction, the allostatic state of addiction. And at the same time, an increase in this phasic signal that will be even more exacerbated by the fact that the tonic level, the background, will be decreased. And this combination can probably explain why you have this abnormal dopaminergic signaling that will lead to all this abnormal behavior. It's pretty interesting, because if you want to think about a therapeutic strategy on the dopaminergic system, if you are able to normalize this tonic, this abnormal low tonic level of dopamine, you will be also able to normalize in one way, in some way, the phasic signal and to restore a normal phasic tonic balance. If you are doing that in the nucleus accumbens, you should reduce consumption. If you are doing that at the level of the dorsal striatum or the nigrostriatal pathway, you should be able to potentially reduce craving and compulsive use. So maybe it's a little bit simple and caricatural, but at least we have interesting prediction that we can test experimentally. So I am done. I really want to thank you for your attention. I apologize if finally I was too long. And I also want to acknowledge all the members of the lab that who participate to this work, and especially Raphael, that really did a really nice job during his PhD, experimentally, but also as a conceptual level. He's very, very great student. I really want to thank him for that. And also our different collaborators, Véronique, that train Raphael for the electrophysiological experiment in the institute, and also Denis and Benoît of the Institute de Biologie and de Pathologie close to the gene that do the analysis for us for the dopamine and the dopamine contents in your or dialysate. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Sébastien, for this very interesting work, presenting this interesting work. Some people are applauding. So who has question? You can raise your hand or just put your mic on. Maybe I can, there is a question from Claudia Fornari. So she's, maybe you can read the question too, Sébastien?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
So why did you choose to apply food shocks to induce ablation rather than adding a bitter taste agent to the ethanol solution?
That's a very good question. Actually, I didn't show this experiment, but the first experiment we did was with the partial nigrostriatal lesion. And maybe I can show you the data. Okay. So before doing DREAD, just to test the hypothesis, we used the partial lesion of the nigrostriatal dopaminergic system we used for motivation before. We exposed the animals to the intermittent access. There was no effect on consumption. It's not working anymore. Okay. After when we did the operant self-administration, there was no effect also on operant self-administration. And then we used 0.9 to do adulteration. And the animal with the 6-hydroxydopamine lesion, they were resistant to 0.9. So it was the first indication of compulsivity. But I was not satisfied by the quinine approach. I prefer the food sac approach for the following reason, is that with quinine, it's really linked to the intake. The animals, they are taking alcohol. You are adding a bitter taste, and they have to go further that to take the alcohol. So it's a negative consequences, but it's really linked to the consummatory behavior. With food shock, what we did, is that during the, maybe I will show you, it is an important aspect of the protocol. Okay, is that the food shock occurs after 8 precise, while the animals have the alcohol delivery every 3 precise. So it means that when the animal will receive the food shock, you will not have the alcohol exactly. So you will have an association more of the food shock with the press than with the alcohol intake. So we will more looking at compulsive seeking than compulsive taking, and it's also an important aspect. So we think that using food shock is the better way to operationalize compulsive seeking than the quinine. But still, we did both with 2 different approaches, and we obtained the same result. I hope that I answered the question.
Yeah, thank you. Pierre Trifiliev has a question too.
Thank you very much, Sébastien. Really nice. So of course, your work makes me think about the work from Marco Leighton in humans, showing that he has this very nice paper where he showed that individual at risk to develop addiction, so who are not even consuming drugs yet, already have a decrease in dopamine in the striatum overall, because they don't have the resolution. So what's your prediction? Let's say you could, I mean, I know with the dread it would be complicated, but you could chronically inhibit dopamine. Do you think the outcome would be different than what you see here, where it's like very focused on the food shock period, let's say? I mean, do you have a prediction about that?
So I think that the result will be the same, because when we did the approach with the lesion, it was to have a stable and permanent decrease in dopamine. And before the beginning of the consumption in the intermittent access. And basically, we obtain exactly the same result. What we would like to do is that in the first experiment, we screened the animals that were sensitive and unsensitive to the food shock and the resistance, and we look at dopamine level after. So we don't know if the hypodopaminergic state that we found linked to resistance to food shock was induced by the drug, or if it was already present before the animals start to drink. So the next experiment we will do will be clearly to look at dopamine levels before in the cohort of animals, and then do the screening and see if the hypodopaminergia was already present at the beginning. It's a very interesting question.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think Nicolas Mallet has a question.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for the great talk. I had a question, is I was curious to understand why you needed chronic C21 treatment and chronic hypodopaminergia before seeing an effect on a shock resistance stance. And it seems to me like the relation is not as simple as low dopamine and shock resistance. Maybe chronicity is also important.
Yeah, I think that chronicity is important. I don't have an explanation. I just have a hypothesis. There is one that it's linked to maybe more physiology, that probably with chronic injection, we are probably making more change in the dopaminergic systems that are persisting far beyond the pharmacological effect of the C21 ligand. That's the first possibility. The second one, it's more a psychological hypothesis linked to the allostasis hypothesis of addiction, is the fact that if you look at this negative spiral and to the allostasis hypothesis of addiction, to become compulsive, you need to experience the negative effect during abstinence. So maybe you need to repeat this short hypodopaminergic state to induce several times the aversive effect of abstinence to be experienced by the animals. Meaning that even in face of negative consequences, he will continue to want to take the drug to avoid that. It's just an hypothesis.
Okay. And second small question is, do you think also this reduction in a dopamine release is associated with postsynaptic change in the level of receptor expression?
We did not investigate that, but I'm sure that there is some change. There is always change at this level to react. So it's something that we have a lot of bank of tissues, and now we will really screen at the cellular level what's going on in the nucleus accumbens, of course, in the dorsal striatum, and also in prefrontal region, and we will look at the receptor, because I'm sure that there is something there.
Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Martin Kader has a question, but maybe it's not the case.
No, thank you, Sébastien. It was the same question as Nicolas regarding this chronicity and maybe some adaptation in the level of the dopaminergic receptor. So I have the answer to my question.
Yeah, I think it's a good way to look at. Yeah, I agree with you. Thanks.
Other questions?
Still have a question.
I was wondering, I was interested by the DLS. My question was, do you think the hypothesis, I really like your hypothesis about the hypo and hyper that are occurring together because there is a tonic and the phasic, but do you think it can also be due to the territories? So maybe hypodopaminergia in some part of the striatum and hyper in other parts?
That's also a possibility that you have hyperdopaminergia in the mesolimbic system, for instance, and hypodopaminergic state in the nigrostriatal pathway. But I don't really think so because at least in the mesolimbic system, people were able to find both at the same time. And I really think that it's the same thing in the nigrostriatal pathway, but the phasic signal need to be investigated. Why I think so? Because if we look at the experiment of David Belin, he was able to block compulsive alcohol seeking by blocking the dopaminergic signals. So if we want to reconcile that with what we obtain, it's probably that, for me, my explanation is that with the antagonist, you will block the phasic signal, and so you will block compulsivity. So for me, I'm pretty sure that there is an increased dopaminergic phasic signal that contributes to compulsivity. But yeah, it's really something that needs to be tested.
And for the DLS, so the dorsolateral striatum, what do you think happens in this particular territory of the striatums to be so implicated in what you've seen?
It's a very good question. I have really no clue. The only things we know is that empirically, we know that with prolonged exposure to drug of abuse, there is first neuroadaptations that occur in the mesolimbic system, and then that progressively migrates to the nigrostriatal pathway. It's a little bit like for any behavior, by repeating the behavior, you have not first, because there is already at the basis a recruitment of the nigrostriatal system, but there is maybe a greater engagement of the mesolimbic system at the beginning. And then when it starts to be fully acquired, when it starts to be a routine, there is a major requirement of the nigrostriatal system. So probably there is this migration of neuroadaptation from the ventral to the dorsal striatum. And that's probably that lead to a late implication of the nigrostriatal system in this pathological state. But still, it seems that even at the initiation, when the patients or animal start to take a drug of abuse, there is an activation of the nigrostriatal system. So there is an early engagement of this system.
Right.
But I have no more explanation. Yeah.
Other questions? All right. Vincent. So, yes, two questions. So, Vincent David and then Jacques Michaud.
Hello, Sébastien. Hello. Thank you very much. This nice set of that. I was wondering, you focused on the DLS in relationship with the compulsive behavior. And did you try to look anywhere else? Or because as you know, compulsivity and also impulsivity, which is a little bit related, are linked to other brain areas, namely frontal areas, prefrontal cortex and all sorts. So even if you didn't try it, what would be your guess about involvement of these brain regions in this process?
That's a very good question. Our conclusion is that the dorsal striatum participate, but of course it's probably and likely not the only region. So it will be interesting, especially as you propose to look at the prefrontal cortex, and my prediction, it will be that by inducing hypodopaminergia in the prefrontal cortex, we may be also able to see compulsive behavior.
Yeah. All right, thanks.
Jacques?
Okay, hello. Thank you for this very nice presentation and very clear presentation. And it's a bit surprising because the topic is very complicated. My question was a bit similar to the one from Vincent. Maybe to extend a little bit this question, I would ask you, what is your opinion about the role of the prefrontal cortex in the allostatic processes you are describing us?
I don't know because to my knowledge, it was not really investigated so far. And I always have big question about the implication of the prefrontal cortex, because there is this view to say, probably there is, and some people show that there is an hypofunction of the prefrontal cortex. So you can lose your control about inhibitory behavior and it can participate in compulsivity. And on the other hand, there is some studies showing that during relapse, for instance, there is an hyperactivity of this system and this participates to relapse and to compulsivity. So it seems to be a little bit like dopamine. It seems that there is, at the same time, an hyper and an hypofunction of these systems that is involved in addiction. And I don't really know what will be the role of dopamine and the modulation of dopamine on this system. What is a loss of dopamine will lead more to an increase of compulsivity or the opposite. It's something that needs to be investigated. I think it's a really complicated question, and so I have no clear prediction about that. I don't know if you have a specific idea.
No, it was just a question of curiosity because I liked the hypothesis of Kube and Lemoyle concerning addiction. So for this reason, I was asking you, what is your opinion as an expert on this domain? And maybe to focus a little bit more on your own work. So do you know what is going on in the prefrontal cortex in your experimental paradigms?
Not yet.
Not yet.
We have the tissues we will look at, but for the moment we don't have any clue about that. But it's okay. A very important question, and we will look at.
Okay. Anyway, thank you very much for your presentation.
Thank you.
Julien Catanez has a question.
Hi. Thank you very much, Sebastian, for this very, very nice talk. I really appreciated it. I have two small questions. One is a little bit technical because I didn't get how do you measure the dopamine in the brain? And it's related to my second question, that is because I really like the model of, that you propose at the end with the tonic and the phasic dopamine release. And I was wondering so depending on the method you use, maybe you can capture that. And the question I had is a little bit open. I'm not sure there's an answer to that, but what do you think would decrease the dopamine level in the case of addiction in general? So it's not linked only to the alcohol, I guess. It's more like a general thing.
Yeah, with all drug of abuse, yeah.
So what would cause this reduction in dopamine, let's say, tonic or phasic, decrease in tonic eventually and increase in phasic maybe also to compensate somehow, I don't know.
Yeah. No, that's a very complex, but that's a very relevant question. Okay. First, what we did with the, when we screened the food sensitive and food resistant animals, we took the whole tissue and we looked at the total content of dopamine with elasite type. So it was not just the extracellular level. So it really means that there is a profound change in the metabolism and the synthesis of dopamine or whatever.
Okay.
So it's not just a change in the extracellular level of dopamine. For the history, why we did that is that we did some microdialysis experiments, but the whole system dysfunctioned and we lose all the samples. So we look, we were a little bit desperate. And so we look at what we were still able to look, and we look at the total content. And we were really surprising to see this this decrease, because it means that it's not only in the extracellular level, it's everywhere in the dorsal lateral part of the striatum. So it leads to your second answer, what's going on? What can cause at molecular level this decrease of dopamine? We were unable to look at that because with the treatment we did with the ELISA, we were unable to do Western blood, look at tyrosine hydroxylase, the enzyme that will lead to the degradation of dopamine. But there is some papers showing that when you have an hypodopaminergic state induced by a prolonged and excessive exposure to alcohol or other drug of abuse, you can have a decrease in the level of tyrosine hydroxylase. So you will have a decrease in the synthesis of dopamine. You can have also an increase in the expression and the activity of the enzyme that are implicated in the degradation of dopamine. So you can have a profound change at this level. For the phasic aspect, it's more an increase in the phasic release of dopamine. Maybe it can be linked to a change at the presynaptic level, in the level of dopamine receptor, for instance, or photoreceptors. But I'm not really aware about this kind of mechanism. I think that it's more related to the glutamatergic input to the ventral tegmental area, because the phasic signals will be mainly induced by stimuli associated to the drug or to the drug itself. And it's probably through the glutamatergic input, because we know that you will have an increase of glutamatergic input to the dopaminergic neurons of the VTA after chronic exposure to drug of abuse. So it's probably this increased glutamatergic input that will lead to an increase of phasic release in the nucleus accumbens or the dorsolateral or even dorsomedial striatum. I don't know if it answers partially to your question. It's still hypothetical.
Right. That's very nice. Thank you.
And not to look at this relation between tonic and phasic, we really need to couple microdialysis with fast cyclic voltammetry to have both aspects of dopamine and see how it can react to alcohol and how are the signal in this compulsive versus non-compulsive animals.
Okay. Yes, and also maybe you can use some recent advance in biosensor for photometry, right?
You're right, yeah, absolutely.
Thank you very much. Think about that. Yeah, bye.
All right, I think we will stop here. thank you very much, Sébastien. Arnaud, I was wondering if we could stay on this Zoom session for a few minutes.
Yes, sure.
Okay, great. So
I will just ask people to leave and check if everybody's.
Yeah. So
we stop the recording.
Thank you very much. Everyone is applauding with the Zoom icon. All right. And thanks for attending, and bye-bye to everyone. So just, Sébastien, if some people...
Je te mets en animatrice, comme ça tu peux couper à la fin.
Merci beaucoup. Je veux bien faire
arrêter mon partage d'écran, voilà, comme ça on peut voir tout le monde.
Voilà, très bien.
Rebonjour tout le monde.